Harper Audio presents a full cast presentation of The Sleeper and the Spindle by Neil Gaiman. It was the closest kingdom to the Queen's, as the crow flies, but not even the crows flew it. The high mountain range that served as the border between the two kingdoms discouraged crows as much as it discouraged people, and it was considered unpassable. More than one enterprising merchant on each side of the mountains had commissioned folk to hunt for the mountain pass that would, if it were there, have made a rich man or woman of anyone who controlled it. The silks of Dorimar could have been in Cancelaire in weeks, in months, not years. But there was no such pass to be found. And so, although the two kingdoms shared a common border, nobody crossed from one kingdom to the next. Even the dwarfs, who were tough and hardy and composed of magic as much as of flesh and blood, could not go over the mountain range. This was not a problem for the dwarfs. They did not go over the mountain range. They went under it. Three dwarfs traveling as swiftly as one through the dark paths beneath the mountains.
Hurry! Hurry! We have to buy her the finest silken cloth in Dorimar. If we do not hurry, perhaps it will be sold, and we will be forced to buy her the second finest cloth.
We know, and we shall buy her a case to carry it back in, so it will remain perfectly clean and untouched by dust.
The dwarf in the middle said nothing. He was holding his stone tightly, not dropping it or losing it, and was concentrating on nothing else but this. The stone was a ruby, rough-hewn from the rock and the size of a hen's egg. It was worth a kingdom when cut and set, and would be easily exchanged for the finest silks of Dorimar. It would not have occurred to the dwarfs to give the young queen anything they had dug themselves from beneath the earth. That would have been too easy, too routine. It's the distance that makes a gift magical, so the dwarfs believed. The queen woke early that morning.
A week from today. A week from today, I shall be married.
It seemed both unlikely and extremely final. She wondered how she would feel to be a married woman. It would be the end of her life, she decided, if life was a time of choices. In a week from now, she would have no choices. She would reign over her people. She would have children. Perhaps she would die in childbirth, perhaps she would die as an old woman or in battle. But the path to her death, heartbeat by heartbeat, would be inevitable. She could hear the carpenters in the meadows beneath the castle, building the seats that would allow her people to watch her marry. Each hammer blow sounded like a heartbeat. The three dwarfs scrambled out of a hole in the side of the riverbank and clambered up into the meadow. One, two, three. They climbed to the top of a granite outcrop, stretched, kicked, jumped, and stretched themselves once more. Then they sprinted north, towards the cluster of low buildings that made the village of Gif, and in particular, to the village inn. The innkeeper was their friend. They had brought him a bottle of Cancelaire wine, deep red, sweet and rich, and nothing like the sharp, pale wines of those parts, as they always did. He would feed them and send them on their way and advise them. The innkeeper, chest as huge as his barrels, beard as bushy and as orange as a fox's brush, was in the taproom. It was early in the morning, and on the dwarf's previous visits at that time of day, the room had been empty. But now there must have been 30 people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.